All right, well, welcome everybody. Dr. John Bartum is here today, and I'm very excited to introduce you to Dr. Laura Salyer, one of my close colleagues and probably the most creative person I've ever met, let alone the definitely most creative doctor I've ever met. And we're excited today to announce the upcoming book release for her first book, and we're going to discuss that today. So Laura, please tell us the title of your book and why you wrote one.
Well, first, thank you, Dr. John, for having me on air with you. It is like royalty. For those that don't know Dr. John, I refer to him as Video King because he's just really inspiring with a lot of his educational content, and it inspires me to think differently about how to deliver really good nuggets for our patients to learn about their body. And I am the meme queen because I like to make everything a little visual and graphic. And so together we've been helping our functional colleagues, and it's just truly pleasurable to be on air with you. So thank you for having me. My book is basically my story. It's my heart poured out on pages, and it's called Right Brain Rescue, One Physician's Journey from Burnout to Bliss Reveals the Creative Muse in All of Us. And it's a little story about my journey into burnout. And what saved me was a couple things. One was a near-death experience. I mean, why not write about that, right? And all of that perspective that I returned to work as a typical family practice doctor. And my perspective was changed. I realized this is not the kind of healing journey that I had wanted for my patients. And it wasn't the kind of doctor that I had wanted to be as an osteopathic physician. We're very holistic. And it had veered so far from that path that it took something very drastic to look again and go, yeah, this isn't what I wanted. And right before I let go of the rope, and we're talking like, I was doing Google searches for like cake decorating, drug mule, like sex ed teacher. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I thought I was gonna break up with medicine totally. Yeah. And in one last ditch effort, I decided to do a conference in functional medicine. I thought, why not? I'm burning up some CME. We know what that's like. And so I attended the conference, and literally on day one, I felt like in love again. It was just like, this is what I want to do. This is exactly what I thought medicine would be like. And so I was hooked, and I resigned 9 months later and opened up my own practice. And so this chronicles the thought process of a vibrant young doctor going into a naive career and then facing burnout and not knowing what's on the other side and taking a chance to be a entrepreneur, you know, and then watching that build up and teaching patients about the empowerment they have in their own body. And so part of that is creativity too. So that's kind of the whole gist of the book.
Awesome. It sounds exciting. And when you were speaking there, I just want to clarify something. Did the near-death experience make, was that a kick in the pants to make the move? Because I'm sure there's a lot of people watching this who are in a job where they're like, I hate this, but I have to do this for my family or for whatever reason, and I'm scared to make the leap. But I believe, right, you know, if you have a near-death experience, there's probably some context that you then see that you didn't see before. And it's like, why waste my life in hell, you know, just for a dollar? So could you speak to that a little
bit? Yes. Well, exactly, John. It's, and I don't feel that any of us need a huge drastic event to make us look. And that's the whole reason I wanted to write the book, is that I believe we all should have little state of the unions with ourselves, like every so often. It's not built into our culture to have times where we pause and reflect. I mean, we lease a car for 2 years. Why don't we lease a partner for 2 years or lease a career for 2 years and then come back 2 years later and go, are we really serving our needs? Is this job what I thought it was going to be? It's especially in medicine, you know, you work so hard to get where you're at, you have blinders on, and it's almost a sign of weakness to say, no, it's not quite what I wanted. And then you don't know where to go. So yeah, the near-death experience was just that final straw. But it, as you read the story, you see hints of this burnout kind of leeching in for years. And it's also just a self-identifying process to say you're burned out is shameful in medicine. Like, no, you should be resilient. I mean, you know, and you get to see in the story being on call in the ICU as a young doctor and all these things you do. And then suddenly you're looking at everything at age 40 going, yeah, I don't want to do this anymore. You know? Yeah. So I think it's empowering to anybody, even outside the medical career, because everybody has burnout in some level, right? We've all had burnout in a career or in a relationship or in even just being a parent. You know, you feel burned out, you know, sometimes you just want to give somebody else that parent hat for a day and say, let me have a rest. And so there's ways to rekindle that spirit inside you, whether it's doubling down on yourself with creativity and all the neuroscience behind that. And that's kind of where my path diverged. And I realized that the skill set that I wasn't honoring was this agency that I'd lost in my career and this ability to just create and be creative and exercise that part of my personality. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, I think that's important too, because whether or not the viewers know it, physician suicide is a huge problem in healthcare, and then leads over to a huge problem for the country, because if our physicians are, you know, taking their own lives when we're already in a physician deficit for the country, that's a big issue. So that speaks to burnout in general, but the model as a whole. And, you know, you probably got into medical school with idealistic, you know, fervor to say, I'm going to get out and save the world. And then you graduate and enter an ICU and work ungodly hours and are not really necessarily treating people the way you probably wanted to. So that speeds the burnout. And as doctors were very left-brained, you know, you aptly titled your book Right Brain Rescue, because the left brain is very focused, details, et cetera, not very creative, not singing, humming, coloring, having a good time. So rescue would be to bring the right brain into it. So how do we do that?
Yes, how we do that is creativity is a brain activation pattern that can be learned and practiced. And in a lot of my keynote speeches, it's very interactive. I like to get the audience standing. I like to get them to use that right brain creativity right there in their seat. So we talk in the beginning about turning that on, because it's a current 24/7 of those alpha brainwaves that are creative. They're the ones that are noticing all the things that you aren't aware of right now, like maybe the scratchiness of the earbuds in your ear, or maybe some other sounds, or the taste of like maybe a ham sandwich you had before, all these little nuances that your brain is absorbing. And as left-brained, you know, analytical clinicians, we tend to categorize. We're playing matching with diagnoses and medications or treatments and protocols. And we forget that inherent humanity and the art of medicine that takes in someone's personality or gait as they walk in the door and see that they might limp with a psoas spasm. You see all these little nuances that you take in. So when I have people walking in and they're sitting there, we talk about imagining just for 30 seconds where they could imagine spending a day. And then we take kind of like the temperature of the room. Like, did your daydream take you outside of the four walls of this room? Did your daydream take you somewhere physically impossible, like out in space? And so it's fun to see that we're all creative at birth, and kids identify as being artists from early on. All the kindergartners are happy to make things and show their projects because they don't have an ego attached to their product. And as adults, we tend to put everything as our ego, and we get worried about making bad art. And so all my patients make art when they come in and stay with me. They partner with me, and on their first visit, they bring a drawing of what they want their next year to look like. And it tells me a lot about their goals, and it gets them using that right brain right away. So I believe everybody could do that every day just by thinking differently about where you want to be in a year.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I am listening to an audiobook right now on trauma, and the author is speaking about how the right brain is the first to develop. We're actually born with the right brain, and then the left brain develops as you become a toddler and learn to speak and do all of that.
Yes.
So we're literally born creative, and then we you know, at least in the US, we society and culture ourselves out of that.
Right. Right. And then, you know, you reminded me of a TED talk, which you might love, The Stroke of Insight, if you've ever seen.
Yep. Norman Deutsch.
Yeah. Well, actually, it's Dr. Jill Bolte Taylor. She was a 35-year-old neuroscientist and had a stroke and could identify what was going on because she's a neuroscientist. Yep. And briefly, like, went into this very beautiful discussion about being right-brained. It's like all the break of the left brain was off, and it's like she could just feel what it was like temporarily, and she's recovered. But it's a really cool TED talk, you know.
Okay, I'll check that out. And you mentioned there's an awesome quote that you've spoken in the past that says a patient's health is directly proportional to their physician's teaching ability. You know, as a teacher, someone who, as the video king, you know, I love to teach on video so that people that may never make it to my office can learn what's going on with them and how they may deal with their issues. So can you speak a little bit to that quote and your view?
I love that. Absolutely. And as you being a doctor, you know that the root of the word doctor is docere, which is Latin, which is to teach. And I think that is the root of what we should be doing. And unfortunately, when you get insurance involved and all these other metrics, and did your patient have their mammogram? Oh, well, we're going to dock you. Or did you, you start to whittle it down to metrics that don't honor what the purpose of our careers are, which is to teach people what went wrong and to avoid that, or how to make them healthier. And I mean, that's our job. And so we are unable literally to do our job when you start needling into all these other value metrics that they're trying to measure how well a patient is by some of these things that don't make sense, right? So as a teacher, you understand that it's only so much we can do in those four walls of an exam room. You have such a minimal time with a patient, and you want them to learn outside. And that's why your videos are so impactful, because people can digest that in their own time and learn again and ask better questions at their next visit. And that's how we get the tools of empowerment. So we're in charge of our own health, and like, I like your logo, the putting pieces together. That's really what we're all doing. And I tell patients, I'm like a Dr. Sherlock Holmes, and we just go through their whole house and see what's going on and help them make sense of it all.
Absolutely. So with the COVID environment and quarantine and isolation, creativity could be a way outside of the walls that you're locked in physically. So could you speak a little bit to that? Like how can people who may be feeling like cage rats right now leverage creativity to, bring some happiness back?
Yes. Yes. Well, it's all about even just thinking differently of the word creative. People have a hard time accepting that word. They immediately are off-putted with that word, especially if they're scientific. Oh, I'm not creative. And all creative is something new and meaningful. So you could take a piece of paper, fold it into a swan, and that's creative because it's something just new. You could be carrying a load of books, or in my case, maybe a bunch of laundry up the stairs, and use your elbow to close the door. That's creative. I mean, it's these little things that we can look throughout our day. And so especially in quarantine, I've had lots of physicians, emailing me and messaging me saying, you've inspired me because look at, I took out my old paints, or I have chalk and I'm drawing with my kids on the driveway, or I decided I was missing this one ingredient in dinner, so I just improvised and added something else and it worked out, and all these little opportunities and invitations to try something just different is all it takes. And especially now when we're so isolated, and it's very sad in just how we're seeing, and I know myself, watching even a movie and you see how people just put an arm around somebody, you're like, wow, that's close, and how sad. We need that oxytocin, that touch, that good hormone. And so when you learn to practice creativity, if you get into flow state, it actually produces all five neurochemicals of happiness. And a lot of research has shown that. So that's one way to get some of that good feeling oxytocin and dopamine and all that wonderful stuff that your brain so much craves.
And so how do we get into flow state? Is it an amount of time, like putting crayon to paper, or how do we train that?
That's a great question. There's a lot of science behind it. A lot of it has to do with mental blocks. We have to allow ourselves just to be free and have no goal in mind. So getting into flow state is simple as just playing in an environment where you feel safe, where there is no expected outcome, but that your skills are matched. And so it's enough of a challenge that doesn't make it too easy, but also is very interesting to try and push yourself a little farther, which is why things like Pinterest are really great for people, because they can look and see, oh, there's some ideas I could try, and then I'll just have fun. And so they've done studies where they've taken medical students and had them go into a control group that just went through their orientation, and the other group went through their orientation and had weekly sessions of creativity where they had to make some projects. And as we've all seen Pinterest, you can have lots of fails and we can laugh at it. It's hilarious to see some of these projects go awry, but you laugh at yourself. And the students that had the creativity were more resilient and more happy and had higher well-being because they were able to make mistakes in like a controlled setting and learn that the world didn't fall apart and you're there for each other. And it's a communal thing. So yeah, it's kind of fun to just give yourself permission to fail, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very important. And I think it's very important to role model that for our kids. And as you're speaking, I'm sitting here, you know, I left the house today and I told my son, hey, I'll come home early. And when I get home, let's hit some baseballs, but he's five. He might rather just go draw with chalk on the driveway, you know, because being out and playing is fun and creative too, but you know, at least my path as a male growing up was get into sports and get technique. Mm-hmm. It's really left-brained with some right sprinkled in. So maybe I'll go home and just make him be creative with me and then I'll be creative too.
I love that. But also, John, flow state is unanimous in sports as well. You've probably been there yourself many times, right?
Yeah.
And
they
call it in the zone, you know, and like you're just focused, your systems, all your senses are on fire. You're like focused. That's the same beautiful thing in your brain as a creative flow state. And so for your son, I would say the best little prescription from, I guess, the creativity doctor would be take the baseball and have fun with it, but make it different. Maybe draw circles in your driveway and see if you can aim it and hit it, you know, and hit those little circles, something different that's not the typical ball and stick kind of thing. Now, again, I'm not a sports person, so I can't give you anything more than that.
Yeah, no, that's fair. That's fair. So how has the functional medicine paradigm allowed you to be more creative compared to the conventional medicine paradigm that you were brought up in, so to speak?
Yeah. It's allowed more freedom to teach for a longer time. Number one, I can have a patient in my office and not worry about the clock and the inability to control my hours or my schedule that, you know, people would just get added on and I wouldn't know that they were waiting for me, you know, that kind of thing. But more importantly, because people struggle with this, and as I mentor other physicians and they're trying to do their own practice, there's a mindset transition as you come from a traditional family practice or internal medicine setting into more of an alternative setting. You feel guilty. You're leaving these patients to care for fewer patients. So you almost feel like ashamed, like you're giving up what you had signed up to do to serve. And the way I explain it to them is you're serving generations. You're serving not just that one patient that you did a suture for or that you did a pap smear on.
Yeah.
You're teaching them and their whole family and then their family and all of the people how to be healthier and how to look for clues. And so that's how I settle it in my heart. And my teaching is now every week we have group visits where my members come and we talk. And then I have, like you, videos and classes. So the teaching happens not just in the exam room, but outside. And you bet, I've had patients say, oh, I had my husband watch with me and he loved it. And, you know, all those things that you can impact generations. So that's kind of the mindset shift, I think, that a lot of people struggle with.
Yeah. And I would just echo, you know, if those practitioners are watching, I see the same in my office. Often, you know, a spouse will sign up for care and I'll tell the other spouse, you know, you're probably going to lose weight and be a fan of me too, because if you're supporting this person in their transformation, you know, you're probably going to be eating like them. And so I have many, many cases where the spouse lost 10, 12 pounds just for supporting, you know, the patient. Or most recently, there was a mother who's lost 50 pounds and her daughter decided to eat how she was eating while she was on her plan. And the daughter lost 31 at age 13. So you could imagine how that impacts that girl right now, self-esteem wise, but then moving forward. So it really...
Right.
The ripple effect, you know?
It is. It's a ripple effect. And I believe very strongly in family systems theory that we're a system. A family is a system. One person changes in that system, it's going to change the whole system, whether you like it or not, you know? And usually what you and I are doing are changing it for the better. So it's that whole, you know, I forget the quote, was it Thoreau that said, always leave a place better off than when you left it, you know? And that's kind of what we're trying to do is help that one family member. And they might be that nidus that just creates exponential growth for generations to come.
Yeah, absolutely. I love it. What else do you want the people to know about the book or about creativity or about Dr. Laura?
Oh goodness, I would just say have fun. I mean, we're here on this earth to be human, a human being not a human doing. You've heard the phrase before. We're here to share our own signature way of being in the world. And in this world now, with such extremism and black and white views and this is right and this is wrong, I like the colors. I like the middle. I like that we need to approach everybody with just intentional love and grace and honor and strength that you are your own creative being. So if anything, just read the book for a great story to get a peek of what it's like, at least from my view. And I'm sure I speak for many. I've had lots of doctors email me saying it resonated and that I read their mind. I mean, they're suffering. And your doctor wants you to be healthy, but if they're trapped in a system that isn't supporting them, please don't take it out on them. You know, maybe hand them the book and say, hey, you know, learn how to wake up that right brain and maybe you'll enjoy life a little more.
Awesome. And another question would be, there's many doctors, obviously, who this book could benefit, but this book, as we've talked about on the interview, could help many lay people. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure in your practice, like in my practice, there's many people who are used to checking vitals at home. They're checking their blood pressure. Some of them are checking their blood sugar. Many are checking their weight every day, right? So mm-hmm. you mentioned that creativity is the sixth vital sign. How can they check that at home?
I love that. Yes, I would love to make creativity the sixth vital sign because, as you might know, years ago, Jayco made pain the fifth vital sign, and that was confusing to a lot of clinicians because it's really a subjective vital sign, and it caused, in my opinion, the opioid epidemic because now we had people saying, oh, you're in pain, let me fix it. And sometimes pain is just a nice smoke signal for where we need to look for the fire and not necessarily put a blanket over it, but find why it's burning. And so it's resulted in this opioid epidemic and a very negative psychology behind healthcare. So my antidote was making creativity the sixth vital sign. So when you come into your physician's room, they don't stop at the pain. They go, okay, what brings you joy? What brings you passion? What is your hobby? Simple as that. And that plants the seeds for you to reflect and go, oh my gosh, I haven't done anything like that in years. And just starting that conversation and ending that being the last question of a vital sign intake would be really a great way to get people to wake up to why are we here? We're not here to burn at the grindstone and we're here to be, you know, revitalized and colorful.
Absolutely. I agree 100%. So where can we find the book?
Yes, please find the book on Amazon, Right Brain Rescue. And that's all you got to do. Just download it. We have a free promotion starting Sunday, September 27th. And you can get it for free on Kindle. And of course, it's available in paperback. And I sincerely appreciate your support and just keep coloring outside the lines.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Lara. And I throw my full support behind her. And I'm going to pick up a copy myself. And for anyone out there, if you are, like Dr. Lara said, if you're seeing a doctor that you're not necessarily thrilled with the care they've given you, perhaps it's the system and not the doctor. That mm-hmm. doctor became a doctor to help you. And I firmly believe that they're probably beaten down by the model. They're not just a bad doctor or a bad person. So hand them one of Dr. Lara's book, save their life. And by doing that, you'll be helping them save the lives of infinite other people, you know. So Dr. Lara, thank you for writing the book. Thank you for the bright light that you are. And I can't wait to hold it in my hands. Good luck.
Thank you, Dr. John.